You know, punks might come, goths might go, but mods will live forever.
I've been a mod since I was 15. I'm 35, 36 this year.
To me, Oasis are mod like Austin Powers is mod.
Not everyone that rides a scooter is a mod.
To the mod, the bike is almost like a pair of cufflinks.
What do you feel you get out of being a mod?
Satisfaction, dress-wise, you know, than the average bod on the street, like, you know, looking different.
We didn't like the motorbikes because they weren't clean.
Down in Brighton, which is a lot more cosmopolitan.
Quite a lot of celebrities have gone for the Velocifero.
Right.
Oasis have one each.
Pride about you.
Smells of the 60s.
It's Brighton today!
James Brown was the ultimate mod.
People should remember Pete Meaden.
There was a connection between the mods and, you know, modern movement, design, functionalism, minimalism, you know, that kind of, and the interest in the new, you know, the kind of clean line, skyscraper kind of version of modernism.
It's in your heart, it's an attitude, I think it's more to do with the way you approach life and the way you think about things, more than the way that you dress, because there are people that can dress up and they're not mods, they're not stylists, they're just dressed up, they're in fancy dress. It's the way you are, it's the way you are towards other people, it's the fact that you're prepared to take risks.
I don't think that it's terribly sensible to look at subcultures per se as causing problems.
I mean, it's very difficult to define, and it's only once you sort of do it or you're there that you know it. It's very difficult to like explain to people that don't know. It's a feeling. And
you got any particularly classic moments that, you know, just a weird?
Yes, I have. When we first took acid.
Really? When did you do that?
At Blackpool. we went for a sauna fully clothed. Yes, quite amazing.
You must have got really hot and sweaty though, didn't you?
In the sauna, yeah.
Why the fuck?
Incredibly stupid. But that's what you do if you're in control of you. Someone suggests something ludicrous and everyone says yes, don't we? But it's hilarious because it's a first trip for about 10 people and we're all just crawling around.
Detail is so important. Four fingers. Four fingers, obviously. This should be one.
Right.
That's class, that is.
What kind of details are you talking about exactly? I mean, are you talking about just the fashion or...?
Everything, including the music and like right. that, in your record sleeves, you're always putting little, tiny things that right. mean something to you
right.
and that means something to the other people who dig what you're into. You're with your mates and you're having a good time, whether it's at a club or if you're in a band, you're playing the music.
Yeah.
And it's like it's just like the whole sort of gang mentality, really.
Right.
Not in a violent way, you know.
But what happened was... And this is the crucial thing, is that modernism was built on elitism, right? One of its values was elitism.
Mm.
So that all these office boys who were going into work, speeding off their heads after a weekend of just doing deck seats, lovely, lovely suits on, you know, great shoes, ties, looking better than their manager, you know, than their boss who was a slob, you know, and lording it over them. That elitist thing between those mods, right, who used to watch Ready Steady Go on a Friday night just to check out what people were wearing. People would, you know, people would go, that, you know, if people were going to be on Ready Steady Go, the top faces would be like, right, what am I going to go on national TV wearing, which is going to freak out everybody else,
right.
you know. So they would all try and think of things, you know, instead of having two buttons there, let's have four, you know, instead of a 5-inch vent, let's have seven, you know, all different things like that. But once it's spread out, that elite, you can't have a mass movement based around it. Elitism, it's the biggest contradiction of all.
Right.
Because if you're elitist, you can't be mass movement. And if you're mass movement, you can't be elitist.
Yeah.
So by 64, modernism was basically dead. And what you had then was a mass movement.
Right.
Which you know, the original mods wanted nothing to do with. Original mods didn't want to go fighting in Brighton. What's the point?
Well, it's very deconstructive.
Yeah, you know, it's demeaning. It's like, what, go and stand on a beach and fight rockers? I mean, what's that about?
Wreck your clothes.
You know, yeah, exactly. Yeah. When you take some speed and go and listen to James Brown, far more productive for you.
Young people are continually innovating. Because that's, you know, in a sense, adolescence is a laboratory for inventing yourself, you know. And we'll often do it through clothes and style and transgressions or mutations on what's gone before.
It's do about some sad, lonely, dysfunctional people. We can't fit in the 90s world, so we're living in the past.
The other thing about, these terms, mods and rockers, is that the groups themselves are often really allergic to these this terminology, you know. Because they're partly, it's a shorthand for the media, you know, and it's not necessarily a sufficiently subtle way for the people involved in the thing to describe themselves.
It seemed to me that the rockers seemed to come down and they wanted to enjoy a weekend in the group.
Right.
The impression I got from the mods were, we're down there in numbers, we can have a bit of fun at the rockers' expense.
Right.
I think that's how it sort of seemed to me to sort of start.
So were the mods kind of taunting the rockers in quite a lot?
Yeah, I think yes, basically. I mean, I'd always grown up with the feeling that the motorbike boys were the hard men.
Mm.
And in some ways they sort of gave off that aura that they were. But I think very much the mods started the taunting because there was safety in numbers. In the quieter moments, you know, because they were, you know, sort of sitting around with the scooters and whatever, and I had one myself, let's not say I was a mod,
right,
but it was a cheap form of transport at the time. And so that gave a common purpose, if you like, apart from anything else, to start talking to them. And they were no different from anybody else.
I think it was just an excuse for two rival gangs to have a bit of a fucking bit of a dust up, really. Right. You know. It's good, you know. It's good that they fought rockers, though.
It was as if somebody gave a signal, and snap, things would change. And suddenly, you know, from being, you know, interested in the vehicles or whatever, it was just, as I say, as if somebody gave a signal, and the whole thing changed, and the surge began.
The bank holidays. It was really, it didn't start out as, there was no intention, I don't believe, initially, to be violent.
No.
But I remember going to Brighton the first year, and I could not believe how many people had turned up on scooters. There were thousands of people on scooters, parading up and down the seafront.
Mm.
Who'd got the newest gimmick? Who'd customised their machine just that much over, more than everyone else? You know? And I think the rockers just decided actually they wanted to do it too.
Right.
And their uniform, of course, was the dark side.
Mm. Yeah. So did when you were down in Brighton and you saw all these scooters and other mods, what were you feeling inside? Were you feeling very happy and very sort of elated and secure? Was that?
I felt as though I really belonged to a movement in the country, to a large body, you know. And it was, you could feel it. And also after the I don't think there was violence the first couple of times, the first couple of bank holidays, which were the times to go. But I remember going to Yarmouth and the first time there, and there were thousands of people there on the bank holiday, and thousands of rockers as well at the other end of the town. And I remember the tension in the air. The adrenaline buzz from it was huge.
So when you were a mod back then, did you feel that it wasn't going to be a passing fad, that it was something that you could never see the end of, kind of thing? Or do you feel that you would grow out of it, type of thing?
I think probably as mods, we never thought that far ahead. I think we probably never thought past our next pair of desert boots at that time. It happened then and now. It was very immediate.
Right.
And it did take over your life. You know, your work was incidental to to your way of life, as it were. All the girls and everybody I knew dressed that way, had hairstyles that way.
I like the clothes, the scooters, and the music. So there's three elements of the mod scene, in my opinion, on this. But, you know, to every person involved in it, you know, they have a different aspect, a different view of it. Right. So it's a very personal thing, I suppose. But I mean, myself, I like anything that's come from the 60s.
Right. So are you pretty detached from like the 90s mod thing, are you?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, when you say 90s mod scene, there isn't such a thing as a 90s mod scene. It's what we call a Britpop scene. I mean, that's not my words. These are what the media have said. Yeah. It's called a Britpop. You know, I like bands like Oasis, Ocean Colour Scene, and blah blah blah. But you know, I wouldn't rush out and buy the records. But I would rather listen to them than Bucks Fizz, for instance. So, you know, that's my opinion of the 90s mod scene. And you know, if anything in that gets into the charts nowadays encourages people to be mods, then it's a good thing.
Mod's one of the few youth cults that always seems sort of contemporary. I don't know why. I mean, maybe it's because people like Weller are always, you know, still look cool, although he's never really moved from that style at all. I mean, you know, like it's taken Paul Weller probably 20 years to move from 1965 to 1968.
Everything dull and grey in England. Let's get some of these coloured clothes.
The Isle of Wight during the 80s, when there was about 20,000 of us on the island, was just like, I mean, that was a superb moment in history. You know, I mean, we really loved, that was really wonderful, you know, for all that many people to be there.
Do you feel that at some point in the whatever late 80s, early 90s, it was, the culture was so elitist that it was killing itself in a way, do you think?
It definitely was, it had throttled itself, but then people like the Young Disciples, Femi and Marco, who were doing the Shake and Finger Pop Club, they were like, started to wear mod gear, and it became very acceptable. And you know, Shake and Finger Pop is a Junior Walker record, you know, which is Tamla Motown 60s. So they were definitely in that mod thing, and so was Paul Weller. He was good mates with them, and they were doing it.
Were you with it in the early 80s kind of thing?
I was really into two-tone. Right. And then in my school, you had all the jam fans, and they always used to fight with people who were into, like, you know, ska, right, which was so daft because ultimately the two things were so similar.
Yeah.
You know, and one was slightly reggae and the other one was on a definite sort of Motown thing, you know, right, what people listened to. But it always ended up, ultimately, when you get a little bit older, you think, well, fucking hell, it's the same music, really.
You know, I just ain't going to talk to someone because they're not, like, wearing what I'm into or they don't listen to the same music. I ain't not going to blank them out or anything, you know.
The true mod facer today can carry himself in any room, in any company. He doesn't have to be in a room full of mods. He can be in a room full of punks. And he can walk from one end of the room to the other with a confident stroll that says, I don't give a fuck, here I am.
It's just a generic,
it's a noun, yeah, an adjective.
Yeah, that's a reason why.
A descriptive word.
Yeah, that's all I feel about it.
It's like a cult,
I mean, you can
like
get about
like a test.
Yeah, there's no sense in saying, well, who is this?
You come down here because contemporary music is hopeless. People have lost their sense of commitment to any ideal. It's quite straightforward because there's soul and there's R&B and jazz. And once you've heard once you've heard that music, then there's no going back. Attitude is as important as taste, I think. But ultimately, it's the music.
There is a definite spiritual side to it, but that's from the music.
Right.
You know, I can't get spiritual about clothes or a scooter, you know, or a haircut. But you know, it's the music, because it's soul music.
Doesn't matter what clothes it is, it's the detail that goes into it, you see. And that's what makes Oasis a mod group. Same with Ocean Colour Scene, same with the Small Faces.
This is the ultimate high.
can't have one without the other. It's no good just being a soul boy. You've got to be into the clothes as well.
You see people going out and actually buying suits, starting to have suits made again, which is what we all used to do. You know, you go out and have something made, and you shy away from the designer stuff. You're actually designing it yourself and having it made yourself. And that's what's happening in the high street, that they've picked up on a lot of the clothes that mods had made, and they've utilised that style, and some of the fashion houses are calling it their own, but it's not. We've seen it all before.
Shoes are very important. Wallabies, sand shoes, obviously, yeah.
I mean, I was always a bit of a clothes fetishist, and it was always a bit of a question mark over, my solidity as a citizen and a proper masculine human being. there was a real fascination with new styles and clothes and so on. And a frustration, because you couldn't, even if you had good taste, you couldn't afford to get the good stuff that you wanted.
So did you have suits made and everything and that kind of stuff?
Yeah. Yeah, you'd get made-to-measure suits. When I was 14, I had a made-to-measure suit, which now costs, God knows, this was like a 50 bob tailor, you just go and it was like, I can't remember how much it cost, but my dad took me and it was like a coming of age thing, And there's that whole thing of standing and getting the second fitting and choosing the material and how many pleats and where the pockets are going to go and everything,
I used to dye some of my shirts to, because coloured shirts and stuff like that was in fashion. I used to dye some of my shirts.
Yeah.
My white shirts. Orange, blue, pink. And I, on one occasion, I dyed a jacket as well.
Well, my hair's bleach blonde, right. Like most blonde girls.
Have you got a Mary Quant hairdo?
No, I would call mine a French line.
Right.
There's loads of different styles. It's like a French line. You can have it with a bouffant, which I normally have, but tonight it's like a college boy French line. It's very boyish style. So it's just, you can go down to your local barber and get this cut, and they'll love to do it. And I bleach it blonde because I like that.
Right.
My dress is original 60s dress. I actually bought it from a place called What the Butler Wore, who do a lot of clothes. Original 60s slingbacks and tights from Dorothy Perkins.
What I really got into, and not really as, I think it's probably, they're quite fashionable at the moment, but it was just like a lot of the scooters and that, because we had the boys from the scooter clubs down there, and it was just like, when I sort of saw Quadrophenia, I thought they had a lot of comedy bikes in there. With all the mirrors and all that, and I just thought some of the stuff that's going on now seemed like really like they were just kitted out nicely and some real detailing.
When they first approached us, they were adamant that they wanted lights, mirrors, aerials with foxtails on, Parkers, Fred Perry's,
pork pie hats, as much chrome as possible.
And we actually managed to talk to the main people involved, and we told them that was only a small period in the mod history, but it was the most publicised period in about 1964. But the style of scooters went through several different changes, and they listened basically. So we had two with lights and mirrors, two plain, and it worked very well. And the only styling errors were their styling errors. Well, they had a guy in a Ben Sherman imitation Fred Perry at Carnaby Street. Clothes, which are
cheap suit.
They're just naff, they're just clone mod gear, basically.
The funny thing about mod culture, I've been to some kind of northern, like a few northern soul clubs where there's still quite a lot of mod presence there, is that there's actually even more attention to detail now than there was in. The last big mod revival was a kind of mass market thing where just like kids would go out and buy a Parker from Millets and think they were a mod. But I mean, the kids that are still into it now are really quite particular about the way they dress.
You've got a mod thing from the 60s that people try and emulate, and then you've got a mod thing of today which is like a mixture of different cultures.
Looking like Austin Powers.
That's the way. I mean, it's gone very swinging 60s as well, the mod scene, and I don't think it really works, because
it's not new anymore, it's been done.
We're more into about being a mod today, the modernist thing of today, moving on, isn't it? It's not about walking around in a park with lights and mirrors to us. It's about, you know,
more attitude than
yeah.
Seed. I think with the seed they talk in plural, don't they, as we do this, we do that. I like to talk as an individual, like what I do, really, rather than have a blanket to hide under.
It's not a static cult. You know, you don't put, even if you put a pin through your nose, you become a punk. But the mod culture is always changing, and there's always something happening within it. So it's always something fresh and alive that's happening. Like now, we're in 1997, and Oasis has come along and put a brand new aspect into it. And that has been going on since the 60s, because that's what it's all about. It's all about, what I said, modism, you know? And it keeps changing.
Well, I haven't actually decided to take up being a mod again, you know, like in the full sense of the word, because you can never really truly reenact a moment in time. It was something that happened and that was it as far as I was concerned.
You could have a group of people in a room and the real faces don't need to go or be involved in a scene. They're doing their own thing and then people are emulating them rather than them going to somewhere and having to pay to get in. They'll be running the place, and in a way that's what we're doing here.
Yeah, I don't think we have to be involved in any scene. I mean, we...
I think that's more of a young kids thing,
yeah.
Where they don't, not quite sure, a bit insecure. They need that security of going to a place where there are a lot of people that look the same and...
But say they are mods.
I don't think the young kids knew what they were doing. They were just doing it because they felt comfortable doing it. I don't think they were thinking about embracing the culture. I think they were just part of the culture without knowing it. Thought they were different from everyone else, but in fact they were a mass movement and very few of them were actually individuals. I think they were...
There was a few individuals. I mean, two, like one springs to mind for me anyway. That was a fellow called Tony Millett. He came from South East London boy. He was... But he used to seem to have wads of money, always had wads of money, like always able to buy it. You would never ever see him in the same clothes twice. He was, you know, he was...
A face? Was he a face?
Yeah, I think he was. Like, if I was to think about him now, he would be... Oh, how could I picture him? He was like a lot of peacock, like, basically. He was, the way he used to dress, hairstyles, different hairstyles. Spend lots of money on clothes and that. Made me feel a little bit, I don't know.
Inferior?
Yeah, to a point.
But there's always someone that's going to make you feel inferior anyway, isn't there? True. Someone is always going to have a better car than you.
Definitely.
You know?
Yeah.
But to me, Marvin Gaye is a mod for the What's Going On album. Because it's the attention to detail in the whole thing. Yeah. You know, the way he looked, you know, even though it was 70s, so he had big colours and everything, but he just looked amazing. Fantastic clothes, and it's the music. At the end of the day, it's just soul music, and it's just from the heart.
I mean, I didn't really listen to the Jam. We tended to listen to a lot more rhythm and blues, like Muddy Waters, Sonny Boy Williamson. A lot of that blues stuff was what was happening in Birmingham. And then obviously moving on a bit later, you've got your Brian Auger and the Trinity coming through, a lot of the Hammond organ sound.
So basically very original 60s.
Yeah. I never really got into the revival. The 79 revival music. I always preferred the earlier music.
Mark Bolan in Town Magazine in 1962 was a major event. The arrival of American R&B acts in his country. The arrival of the scooter in his country, major event. Clubs such as The Scene, and all the clubs around the country, major events.
There's a lot of people that have got very fond memories of the mod culture and the mod scene, and it's helped them grow up and have good taste in all sorts of things, like, you know, vehicles, music, etc. I think it's a very good learning process being involved in it. Yeah. But I think there comes a time when you have to leave it behind and face up to the real world and responsibility.
The real mod groups, I suppose, were the Kinks and the Small Faces.
Right.
But And they were fine, they were peaceful. Mm. But then people like The Who came along and in some ways hijacked the scene.
Modernism is the most enduring youth cult ever.